The title of my message is, Have You Heard His Call? In this text that we have here, the Bible tells us, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death. Jesus took on the form of a man and came to earth to die. Why would he do that? There's lots of reasons why he would do it, but this passage goes on and it tells us one of the reasons. For the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. It says in verse number 10, for it became him. Now, you don't hear it as much nowadays. Manners aren't as good as they used to be a generation or two ago. But it used to be that somebody would, you know, if somebody came in with a new outfit on or something, you say, oh, that's very becoming to you. Meaning that it makes you look really nice. It's a nice color for you. It highlights your hair or your eyes, or it makes you look straight and tall, or slenderizes, or makes your arms look big. I mean, whatever it does, it's becoming. It makes you more attractive. It causes people to want to look at you, to check you out, not in a bad way, but it calls attention and makes you more beautiful, more easy to look at. It says here, for it became him, for whom are all things. Here it's talking about creation itself. Everything that there is was made for God's glory and enjoyment. That includes you and I. And by whom are all things? Jesus Christ, our Savior, the captain of our salvation. Nothing was created. The Bible tells us nothing was created without him. Without him was not anything made which was made. Okay? To make the captain of our salvation perfect through sufferings. He became more beautiful to us. The Bible tells us to look on him, there was nothing that would attract you to him, but because we know that he suffered and died for us, it's all that much easier to love him. When somebody goes the extra mile for you, when they do something out of the ordinary to show you that they care, I have tried to teach myself. Whenever I'm driving around, I see somebody broken down, somebody stopped beside the road or something, I stop and make sure they're all right. I try to always stop and make sure that they're not out of gas or, a flat tire or something that I can do to help. Maybe their car quit working or, I just want to make sure they're safe and all of that. And I have come to find out, people don't expect that. They, at first, they're a little taken back. And then when they realize that you're only there because you want to try to do something nice for them, they're pleasantly surprised and they appreciate it. Well, here Jesus Christ did something that, you never would expect the creator of the whole world to come and take on a human body and then to willingly go to the cross and die for you. But that's what Jesus did. He is the captain of our salvation. The Bible tells us he's the author and the finisher of our faith. And he calls us. Jesus Christ, the captain of our salvation, calls us. We're told in the book of Matthew, chapter 11, and again, I would encourage you, if you might want to jot down these Bible references. I'll give you my point and the title of that point, and I'll give you the references. If you try looking them all up, we're going to be here a long time. Okay, and I want to get through this message in 1 week. Something I was going to mention as I started, and I guess this is a good time to do it. This is my next to the last time for doing this for a while. Next week will be my last Wednesday, and then Brother Chuck or Aaron or somebody else is going to be doing a few months of Wednesday nights. So, at first I thought, wow, 3 months of Wednesday nights, that seemed like a long time. But next week's the last week. It seems like it got here mighty, mighty fast to me. I don't know how you feel about it, but. So anyways, have you heard his call is the title of the message. Have you heard his call? And then kind of a subtitle, if you've heard his call, what is your answer? Now, point number one is that we are called to come by the captain of our salvation. Point number one, we are called to come by the captain of our salvation. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, we read this. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Now, I always enjoy pointing out to people, and I don't think it's needful to point it out here, but I don't know who's behind here. You know, you notice that it doesn't say, "Come unto me, all ye that loiter." It says, "All ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." The captain of our salvation calls us to come unto him for rest, for salvation. John 6:37 says, "All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out." In Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 2, we read, "Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God." Jesus Christ calls to us. He calls to all the world. He says, he tells us in his word, God is not willing that any should perish. There is no need for anyone to die and go to hell. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God sends out a message. And I guess this is a good, because it just popped into my mind, this is a good time to remind each one of us that God sends that message out through us. Well, any person who has received Jesus Christ as their Savior is given the ministry of reconciliation. It's our job to be an ambassador for Christ and to take that message and to call the people, come to Jesus. He's the only way of salvation. There is no other way. You can't be good enough. You can't give enough money to the church. You can't do enough good deeds. You can't be baptized enough times. The only way to be sure that you're going to heaven when you die is to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. The Bible says, "But as many as received him," Jesus, "to them gave he power to become the sons of God." It seems like I say this frequently, but it needs to be said. We're not all God's children. You are not God's child until you receive Jesus as your Savior. Getting baptized as a baby didn't make you God's child. Becoming a church member doesn't make you God's child. Receiving Jesus Christ as your Savior does. And so he beckons and he calls us. The captain of our salvation, it says, "For it became him, it made him more beautiful, more attractive, for whom are all things and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory." God wants sons and daughters. He wants men, women, boys, and girls to come unto him, to repent of their sin, and to receive Jesus into their heart to be their Savior, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. So we're called, first of all, point number one, we are called to come by the captain of our salvation. Point number two, we are called to confess his name. Point number two, we are called to confess his name. Matthew chapter 10, verses 32 and 33 says this: "Whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess also before my Father which is in heaven. But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven." We're called to confess his name. Romans 10:9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. 1 Timothy 4:12, "Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity." We are called to confess his name. God doesn't want secret, behind closed door Christians. Now, I understand that there's places in the world where people have to hide. But by God's grace, those of us who live in America, that's not the case, at least at this point in time. One of the hot topics, you know, is you get out and you start talking with people. People are starting to think that it might be around the corner. We'll see that here in America. And I don't know, maybe we will, maybe we won't. But God doesn't want us to be secret Christians. He wants us to confess his name. He wants us to be an example to other people. When people watch us, when they see how we live our life, when they see how we conduct our business, how we go to our job and how we perform it and how we treat our wife or treat our husband or raise our children, as people watch any aspect of our life, they ought to be able to tell that there's something really different about that person. We shouldn't just blend into the crowd. People ought to be able to see Jesus in us. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 11 and 12 says this: "Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens, being on fire, shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat." What manner of persons, realizing that that we're living in the last days, looking round about us and seeing everything that's taking place here in the United States of America, what manner of people, what kind of people ought we to be? We name the name of Christ, we call ourselves Christians. What kind of people should we be? We ought to be the kind that confess his name to people, where we tell them, "I live this way because I don't go there because I, you know," and whatever it is that we're doing or not doing, it ought to be because of Jesus and his word. So we're called to come by the captain of our salvation, point number one. Point number two, we are called to confess his name. Have you heard his call? That'd be the first, you know, especially for that first point. We're called to come by the captain of our salvation. We're called to come to Jesus to be saved. Have you heard that call? And what did you say when you heard it? That's the follow-up question. As I look around the room, this is not a point that needs to be made as hard here tonight. But as I think about how many might be listening online or on their phone or something, I need to encourage you to stop and ask yourself, have you heard that Jesus Christ calls you, beckons you, pleads with you to come to him for salvation? He wants to save you. He wants to be your heavenly father. He wants to take you into his family. He wants to build a home for you in heaven. If you've heard the call, what did you say? Then we are called to confess his name, point number two. If we truly did receive Jesus as our Savior, we need to tell people so. With our mouth and with our actions, with the way that we live our life. Point number three, I need to move on because I've got, that many points. I'm not even going to tell you, let you wonder a while. Number three, we are called to a life of consecration. Consecration, that is the act or the ceremony, if you will. Sometimes a ceremony is held for it, but it's an act of setting something aside. It's very akin to or almost the exact same thing as sanctification. It's the act whereby you take something and you set it aside for a special holy purpose. Here at the church, sometimes we'll have a baby dedication. Husband and wife, they'll bring their new baby and they'll stand before the church and they'll declare their intent to try to raise that baby to know Jesus, to love Jesus. They promise they're going to try to teach that baby about Jesus. We are called to a life of consecration. In Leviticus chapter 20, verse number 7, the Bible says this: "Sanctify yourselves, therefore, and be ye holy, for I am the Lord your God." Joshua chapter 3, verse 5. "And Joshua said unto all the people, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you." In 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse number 5, we read this. They were collecting things for the house of God, to make things for the house of God. And I said, the gold for things of gold and the silver for things of silver, and for all manner of work to be made by the hands of the artificers. And who then is willing to consecrate his service this day unto the Lord? We are called to a life of consecration. We are to set ourselves apart from the world. God says, come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you and be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. He wants us to live a separated, sanctified, holy, consecrated life. And I'll tell you, I'll be real honest with you, that takes constant diligence. And it's not as though you do this one time and you're all done with it. You're going to have to do it again, and you do it again, and do it again, and do it again. I've got to stay real close here because I didn't put on a tight clip microphone tonight. Usually we work that out, and I put one on for them. They don't worry about it too much because I usually stay pretty close to this, but I was going to step aside, you know, when I was talking about that. But a life of consecration. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 and 18 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. I really have to believe that part of the reason that I have trouble, and part of the reason that many of us as Christians have trouble reaching people, that we try to witness to them, we try to talk to them, we try to share our faith with them, we try to tell them about Jesus, and we wonder, why is it I can't get them interested? Why don't they pay closer attention? Why do they not listen? I'm afraid that many times it's like, I forget I'm supposed to live all the time a sanctified, holy life. And, you know, the truth of the matter is, it's not that you don't have to do horrible, awful, wicked, sinful. You don't have to have a filthy, you know, vocabulary and stuff to blend in. We're not supposed to blend in, folks. People are supposed to know that there's something different about us. We're supposed to be different, sound different, look different, behave different, react different, and act different. A life of consecration. So we're called to come by the captain of our salvation. Come for salvation. We're called to confess his name, point number two. Point number three, we're called to a life of consecration. Point number four, we're called to a life of constancy. Constancy. 1 Chronicles chapter 28, verses 6 and 7 says this. And he said unto me, Solomon thy son, he shall build my house and my courts. For I have chosen him to be my son, and I will be his father. Moreover, I will establish his kingdom forever if he be constant to do my commandments and my judgments as at this day. Now, you know, one of the things I have found difficult about the Christian life, you know, the Holy Spirit comes and he starts to minister to your heart, and he starts to convict you of the sins in your heart, whether they're big or whether they're little, the things that we, you know, you do them over and over and over, and all of a sudden you start to realize, well, I shouldn't be doing this. I shouldn't have that feeling. I shouldn't have that attitude toward that person. And he starts to convict you about it, and pretty soon you find yourself, you're reading your Bible, and you're spending time in prayer, and you're confessing it to God, and you're getting it out of your life. And then, you know, things are going pretty well for a little while. But before you know it, because our attention gets off on something else, before you know it, we're slipping back in to that old way of life. We're called to a life of constancy. We need to be constantly checking ourselves out, redirecting our focus, getting things where they need to be, and working to keep them there. Luke chapter 12, verse 42 says it this way. And the Lord said, who then is that faithful and wise steward whom his Lord shall make ruler over his household to give them their portion of meat in due season? Who is that faithful and wise steward? When God puts something into our care, into our hands to take care of, how faithful are we? How long do we give it the attention that we're supposed to be giving it? 1 Corinthians 4:2 says, "Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful." Oh, one of my wife's favorite verses is when God says, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." That she longed to hear that. She asked that it would be put on her gravestone, and it is. One of her favorite songs that Ron Hamilton sang was about being faithful. "I want to be faithful, I want to be true." We're called to a life of constancy. Galatians 6:9 says, "And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not." It's not enough that we start out doing the right thing. It's not enough that we do the right thing for a year or 2 years or 5 years or 10 years. You know, it may surprise you to hear me say it this way. I've had the blessing, I've had the privilege of almost dying and yet still being alive, being out walking about and talking. And one of the things that I found that when you honestly believe that your time here is short, you want things between you and your Savior to be right. And when they are, you can face death without any fear, without any hesitation. It's perfectly all right to go. I think of my wife. Some of you have maybe heard me tell of my dad's passing. I honestly believe my dad literally talked God into taking him home. He was fine. The doctors told us all that the day before he passed. But the whole time while I was making a meal for him, he was talking, Lord, how long are you going to leave me here? Lord, you took Jenny a year ago. Lord, you know there's nothing here for me. We sat down to eat and bowed our head to say, you know, our prayer. And I had taken almost an hour making lunch for Penny and Dad was sitting on the couch, and we bowed our head and prayed, and I said amen. And just as I said amen, Dad went, "Oh!" And, whoa, startled us, and ran across the room to where he was laying on the couch, and he was gone. Totally, completely, not an eyelid fluttering, not a gurgle, not a gasp, not a twitch. And I've seen several people pass. That's the first time I've ever seen anyone pass where they were just gone. And you know, my dad, he wasn't afraid of dying at all. He was pleading with his Lord to take him home. My wife, she was ready. When I was real sick, by God's grace, I was facing death without any feelings that I had to make things up or that, you know, no guilt or anything. I was ready to go. That's one of the things that a life of constancy does for us. Gives you the ability to live your life without being afraid of dying. Not that we're in a hurry to. You know, people ask me how I'm doing. I tell them, I'm old. My game plan is get as old as I can get. You know, I'm not in a hurry to leave here. But at the same time, it's such a wonderful, freeing thing to have the relationship with Jesus Christ that you don't have to be afraid and worry about dying. You don't have to worry about where you're going. We're called to a life of constancy. Number five, we're called to come bearing our cross. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24 says this, "No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon." We get this weird idea somehow that we can serve God and we can put him first in our life, but we'll do it whenever it suits our purposes. You know, oh, come Sunday morning. Yeah, I'm going to be at church. All right. I'll make sure that I'm there on time. And, you know, every one of us, there's no doubt in my mind, anybody who comes to church faithfully has walked in the church, sat down, and, you know, like you get up and you're dashing all around. Something's happened at the house. And for us, it was always at the last minute, the baby would mess their diaper or they would barf or something, you know, and put you kind of behind the eight ball where you're dashing to get to church. And you walk in, you sit down and go, and you get that few moments of time to unwind because it was such a stressful thing to get here. But things in life of that sort are one thing, but so many times we find ourselves having to choose between fishing trips, camping trips, golf outings, a day at the zoo, all sorts of things that pop up as an opportunity that we could go there instead of going to church. And so we find ourselves, you know, oftentimes I have, you know, you guys know I'm working again now. So many times, just about 3 or 3:30 in the afternoon, a really good trip will come up where they need somebody to drive a couple of hours, you know, several hours away or something, and it would mean that I wouldn't be able to be here on time on Wednesday nights or whatever, you know? Or sometimes a Saturday night where it would keep me out late in the evening and wouldn't get back until 2 or 3 or 4 o'clock Sunday morning. It's like, no, thank you. You better call somebody else. We have to learn to come and to only serve one master. We're called to come bearing our cross. Let me get back to my notes here. Luke chapter 9, verse 23 says this way. And he said to them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Daily. It's not a once and it's done type of thing. It's daily. Luke chapter 14, verses 27 and 28. He says, and whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it? You know something, if we say we're going to follow Jesus, we need to count the cost. We need to look and see what there is in our life that's preventing us from following Jesus and doing the things that he sets in front of us that he wants us to do. Before we let him put something in our hands, we need to take a look and say, you know, not am I physically myself. You know, God, here's the other thing. God doesn't ask you to do something he won't enable you to do. But before we say, yes, we'll do it, we need to make sure that we're committed to it. And we're not going to let something else get in the way of it. Romans 13, 14 tells us this little bit of advice. It says, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lusts thereof. You know something, if we just make up our mind ahead of time that we're not going to, you know, for me, when I hired in, I just told him, I don't work Sundays. I'm not working late Saturday night because that's going to interfere with me getting to church on time. I'm not working Wednesday. I go to church Wednesday night. You know, I need to be off at such and such a time. And I've had opportunities, and they asked a couple times at first. But you know what? If you stick to your guns, if you're consistent, if you're faithful, they get the idea, and they don't ask anymore after a while, and it gets easier. Come, called to come bearing our cross. 1 Timothy 6:12 tells us this. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. Fight the good fight of faith. Come bearing your cross daily. Make up your mind to begin with what you're going to do, where you're going to place your importance, and stick to it. Point number 6. We are called to spiritual combat. There's a spiritual fight taking place every moment that you're awake, and sometimes you're hardly even awake. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 12 says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." We are called to spiritual combat. We're told in 1 Timothy 6, "Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life whereunto thou art also called and hast professed a good profession." We need to make up our mind that we're going to be in a fight every day of our life. The devil, the only thing you can say for the guy is he doesn't give up. He keeps coming after you and keeps coming after you and keeps coming after you. That's why God tells us in 2 Timothy, he says, "Thou therefore endure hardness." 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. "Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier." Endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Don't get all so wrapped up in this world that you can't do spiritual battle for God. You're going to, every one of us who know Jesus as our Savior are going to have opportunities come our way to speak to someone about Jesus, to talk to someone about their sin, to point them to our Savior, to remind them that they're going to die someday. You know what? If you come up with a smooth, easy way to bring up the topic with someone that they're going to die, you let me know what that is, because I've been looking for some smooth, easy way. I haven't found it yet. But you know something? It's not a kindness to let people go on thinking they're going to live here forever, because it's not going to happen. One of my favorite ways, I mean, you know, people all the time are talking about getting old, you know. And they're telling me how they don't want to get old. And I just kind of turn that around. It's my full intention to get older and older. And I point out to them, "Do you not realize that you have two options? You either A, get older, or B, you die. Are you ready to die? And if you're not ready to die, let me, you know, we need to have a little talk." Endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Point number 7. Has anybody noticed that so many of these are called with the C word? Anybody notice that? Called to be courageous. Point number 7. Joshua 1:7 says, "Only be thou strong and very courageous." This is the verse we used last week. "Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest." We are called to be courageous for Jesus Christ. We shouldn't be afraid to look people in the face and tell them first that we are a Christian. I know it might shock them. They maybe had no idea, but shame on us if that's the case. But we shouldn't be afraid to tell people that, A, we're a Christian. We shouldn't be afraid to invite them to church. "You know, I really think you'd like my church." I tell people that. All of you who are sitting here, I brag about you guys all the time. I do. I tell people how friendly you are, what nice smiles. I talk about your nice children and grandchildren and things. Tell them that they ought to bring their kids. We have good teachers, good classes, and all that kind of stuff. And I tell them that because I believe it's the truth. 1 Samuel 12:24 tells us this: "Only fear the Lord." Don't fear other people. Don't be afraid to tell them about Jesus. Don't be afraid to tell them that you're saved and that you're born again, you're headed for heaven, you're going to be in church on Sunday, and you know that you know what? If they'll come and visit your church, at least there'll be somebody that they'll know, because they'll know you and you'll be here. And they should be able to depend on that. Only fear the Lord and serve him in truth with all your heart. For consider, I love the way this verse ends. For consider how great things he hath done for you. You know, when somebody's gone out of their way for you and done something really, really nice, and then they come up afterwards and they need you to do something. My neighbor and I, we have a really nice relationship. And I have, from the time that they moved in, I've tried to befriend them and do nice things for them. And then, you know what, I found out it's easier to get my lawnmower stuck than I thought it was. And I've had to call him a couple times and ask him to come, you know, bring his tractor and pull me out. And you know what? He was glad. He was tickled to get to do it, to do something nice for me. And that's how it works. And when you stop and you think about all the wonderful things that God has done for you, how can you not want to do something for him? How can you not want to tell people what he's done for you? It's the common reaction is what happens within us. Proverbs 29:25 tells us, the fear of man bringeth a snare, but whoso putteth his trust in the Lord shall be safe. Jeremiah 1:8 says, be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee. You know, it's so easy to walk up and you make up your mind. I've been wanting to witness him for a long time. Next time I see him, I'm going to. And then all of a sudden, he turns the corner. It's like you stand there face to face and you don't know what to say. Just spit it out and say it. I've been looking for an opportunity to talk to you. I've been wanting to invite you to church. Spill the beans right out there. Get it out in the open. Don't be afraid. If you seem a little flustered, a little, you know, tense, they'll get a kick out of it. They'll probably tease you about it. Take it good-naturedly and just keep on inviting. Hebrews 13:6. We're talking about being courageous so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. When you know that God wants us to go to talk to people, you think he's going to step back and just leave you out there all by yourself on your own with nothing to say, and you know your mind's not going to start working and your tongue's not going to start working? I mean, when you step out and begin to obey and do what God wants you to do, he'll help you do it. He'll see you through it. So we're called to be courageous. Point number eight. Eight? Yeah, we're all the way up to eight. We're going to ten. I'll let the cat out of the bag. Called to a life of conquest. You know, there's an awful lot of times in your Christian life you feel like you're getting beaten up. No, you have to, you know, sometimes people aren't very nice. And yet we're to continue to be nice to them anyhow. We're called to take it. We're called to suffer for Jesus' sake sometimes. But you know what? We are called to a life of conquest. In Romans chapter 8, starting at verse number 37, Paul writes this. He says, nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. A life of conquest. We are more than conquerors, he says. Now you think of conquerors back in the day that this was written. Well, even now... United States, when we conquer somebody, it's not very long afterwards. We go in and we rebuild everything and build it nicer and better than it used to be. But that wasn't the case, you know, a long time ago. Usually when somebody conquered something, they went in and they took everything. Took it all over. We're more than conquerors, God tells us. He tells us in Romans chapter 12, be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. 1 Corinthians 15:57 says, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. That was 1 Corinthians 15. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. Now, thanks be unto God. I love this. Now, thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to triumph in Christ, and maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. Now, let's get slow down for just a moment and look at this verse. Now, thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to triumph in Christ, and maketh manifest, makes plain and easy to recognize and see the savor of his knowledge by us. God uses us to make the idea of a relationship with God smell like cooking steak in people's nostrils. He uses the way that you live your life, the way that you pay your bills, the way that you treat your wife, the way that you raise your children, the way that you treat your neighbors. People sit back and they watch you, and when they realize that you're living this peaceful, contented, happy life, simply as you are, simply because you love Jesus Christ and you serve him. And that spreads the knowledge of God all around. And he uses us to do that. What a blessed thought that is. I think most of us have been driving down the road, just minding our own business, talking and chatting, and, you know, all of a sudden, somebody's having a barbecue. And it just drifts in the window of the car, and, oh, it smells so good, and your mouth starts to water, and you think about how long it's been since you've eaten and things. And you know something? People watch how you live your Christian life. They watch how your children honor you and respect you and obey you and interact with you and look out for you as you get older. And they look at how you treat your wife and how your wife treats you and how you meet each other's needs and how you are with your brother or your sister. And it's like they go, wow. Man, my family's a wreck, but I wonder what they, you know, man, how they do that. And then they have to come to the realization, it's because of Jesus Christ in you. What a blessed, wonderful thing to think that God uses somebody like me in a way like that. Somebody like you. Let's not kid ourselves. It's not just me. It's you too. God uses you in a way like that. Called to a life of conquest. Now thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to triumph in Christ, and maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. Ye are of God, little children, 1 John 4:4. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Point number 9. We are called to call unto him. God calls us and tells us, when you've got a problem, call on me. When you have a need, when you have a concern, call on me. Jeremiah 33:3. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. And show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. I wrote down a verse here I got to turn to real quick. I don't have it printed on my sheet. I'm turning to Psalms 145. Off the top of my head, I can't remember what it says, but I know that I'm supposed to read it right here. Psalm 145, verse 18. The Lord is nigh unto all them that call upon him, to all that call upon him in truth. He says, call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Things you can't even imagine, God will show us. We need to learn to expect great things from God and attempt great things for God. There's nothing that if don't take this out of context. You're not going to be able to sprout wings and fly, okay? But there's nothing that you can't do for God. If he puts it in your heart and in your mind and he wants to do it, to go talk to someone, to witness to someone, to start some ministry, to fix something or supply something, if God puts it in your mind and in your heart, he will enable you to do it. Expect great things from God. There's nothing too hard for God. Any need that you have, any concern that you have, take it to him in prayer. He cares. He loves you. Expect great things from God. Attempt great things for God. James chapter 4, verse 2 tells us this. Ye lust and have not. Ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight and war. Yet ye have not because ye ask not. We need to learn to call unto God and tell him what we want. Pastor says, oftentimes I've heard him say, talk about the importance of being specific. Being specific when we pray. We need to take our heavy burden. There's a song, take your heavy burden to the cross. No, leave your heavy burden at the cross and go free. Oh, sinner, go free. But call unto him. We are called by God to call unto him. He tells us in his word to call unto him, and he will answer us. And then point number 10, and then we'll be done. We are called to eternal comfort and rest. And again in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, he says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 9 through 11 says this, there remaineth, therefore, a rest to the people of God. For he that has entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works, as God did from his. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. God tells us to work, for the night is coming. We're to labor now that we'll enter into his rest later. God says, I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Eternal rest, eternal comfort with God Almighty. What more can you ask? What more could you want? Have you heard his call? If you've heard it, what was your answer? What was your answer? Let's pray.